All right. Good afternoon, Lift Community Church. Thank you for joining us for our noon live Bible study. We are so glad that you are with us, even though it's virtual. Take a few minutes out of your day while you eat lunch and do a little Bible study. We are continuing our journey through Lent. It's hard to believe we're only a few weeks away from Easter, but we are in week 4 already of Lent. So we have 2 more weeks till Easter. We are talking about giving up some things so that we can have more of what God wants for us. So craving less to get more of God's good. And we're using this book, Simple and Free, by Jen Hatmaker. And today we're talking about spending. This Sunday we'll be talking about spending, and then next week will be stress, and then the following Sunday will be stress, which is Palm Sunday, and then we'll have Easter, Resurrection Sunday. So it's coming together, coming to a fast approach, really. It's hard to believe. But all right, let's open with a word of prayer, and then we're going to get started. Gracious God, thank you for this opportunity to meet virtually, to take a break out of the middle of our week, in the middle of our day, and just to focus on you and to listen to what it is that you would say to us. And so we do ask for your Spirit to speak to our hearts, that every person listening to these words might hear from you something that they need to be your disciples in the world. And we thank you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so spending. I don't know. This is a tough topic. It's a tough topic, I think, for most of us because we live in a consumer-driven society and culture, and how we use our money and spend our money is a real thing. And when you get your card, on this Sunday when you come to church, we're going to give out the cards that have different ideas of things that you can think through about how you spend. And one of the suggestions is to take like your bank and credit card statements and to go through those and for like a month and just see where all your money has gone for the month. And see if there's any surprises, see if there's any changes that you can make. And I think that's a good place to start. I really do. Because I think for most of us, and it's kind of what she points out in the book, that she was surprised at, it wasn't like big purchases and things, that it was just these little drips of where their money had gone as a family over the course of the month. And it all added up. It all adds up. Things like, well, I didn't feel like cooking that night, so we went out to eat as a family, or we ordered food. And I know that's a common thing. Having children, it's, I don't want to eat at home. Let's go out to eat. So we as a family have made the decision. I should say I did. It's me and Olivia. So, even if she wants to go out, she has to do what I say. And we have dedicated one night a week that we go out to eat. Come to think of it, I just was thinking about when I was growing up. I remember Friday nights, my mom would do like homemade pizza or tacos on Friday nights, and that was like the only night of the week we could have soda. We didn't, get like Coke and so on, because we didn't get to drink that during the week. So we always look forward to Friday nights as a family, as children anyway. But for my daughter, what we do is we eat out on Thursdays because she has cheer practice. And so that's our time afterwards to grab something to eat, and we eat out. All right, so spending. So we've already talked about possessions a couple weeks ago, and that's about money that you've already spent and what you do with your possessions. That's about money that's already been spent. This is what we're going to talk about in terms of spending is what you do with your money now and in the future. And I don't really want to get into like necessarily how she set it up, because we'll talk about that more on Sunday, and you'll see that on the card. But What I really want to think about is that spending is a precursor to possessions. And she says that in the chapter, that spending is a precursor to possessions. Because all those possessions that we thought about and that we had to get rid of, like, and so like Olivia and I went through all of her stuffed animals and gave away a huge garbage bag full of stuffed animals. We spent money to get those stuffed animals. Some of them we spent ridiculous amounts of money on because she wanted to win those stuffed animals at the Texas State Fair because we love the state fair, and that is something that we as a family do. We go usually 3 or 4 times during the course of the fair. We get season passes. And you know, the Midway, it's ridiculously expensive. Possessions are spending is a precursor to possessions. And so we really have to think through how we spend our money. Now, I just thought that she had some points in the book that I thought were worth pointing out. One, that annually the United States spends approximately $8 billion on cosmetics. Annually, the U.S. and Europe combined spend on pet food $17 billion. The U.S. and Europe combined spend $12 billion on perfume. Now, if we look at, now this is just U.S. and Europe, which are the wealthiest, where the most of the wealth is concentrated on the globe. But if you look at what, as a globe, we spend on other things, so clean water for all global citizens, $9 billion. Basic education globally, $6 billion. Basic health and nutrition for the globe, $13 billion. Now these figures come from the United Nations Human Development Report that they put out each year. And they define human development as expanding the richness or fullness of human life rather than the richness of the economy. It focuses on people and their opportunities and choices. Now, this is staggering when you think about it, that we spend more on pet food than we do on basic education and clean water combined. Think about that for a minute. That's huge, right? That's huge. The Pew Research Foundation says that the top 10% of the wealthy make 5 times as much as those at the bottom of the wealth index. And I'm not an economist, but since the year 2000, the bottom 3% of wealth have only seen their wages increase approximately 3%, whereas those at the top have seen their wages increase 15.7%. So it's their, it's just, it's staggering. It's 5 times as much, more than 5 times as much. And so that what that translates to is that those who make the most keep making more than those at the bottom. Not only do they make more, but they see increases to their wealth more than those at the bottom. And that translates into spending power. And spending power communicates a lot. So we do want to think through how we spend. And so she has a list of things that we use. And I was like, ooh, you know, I totally resonated with some of these. We say, oh, it's no big deal. I can buy this. I can afford it. I've worked hard for my money, so I can spend it on something that I want. I want this, so I'm going to get it. I deserve this. Other people spend way more. I still have money in the bank. So those are rationales for spending that different people use, that I've used, that we probably all can relate to. And that's rationalizing spending, which isn't about critically thinking about how we're spending, which is, I think, ultimately what Jesus would want us to do, is to think critically about how we use the resources that God has graciously provided and given to us. Overall, as a percentage, the wealthy give less than those who are less wealthy. And those at the bottom of the income hierarchy, they give more percentage-wise. Now, money-wise, obviously the wealthy give more because they have more to give, but a percentage of their income as a percentage of their wealth, it actually is less than what people at the bottom give. I have a friend who he comes from a family who has lots of money, and I shared that with him once, and he got really angry about it. Because he really wanted to focus on the amount of money that is given by those who have wealth. And I said, that's great. And that money does go to good things. But if you want to look at a percentage, right? If we gave a percent, if those who are at the top of the income spectrum gave as much percentage-wise of their income as the poor do, it would be vastly more money. And just think of the more good that that money could do. Because ultimately, what Jesus really wants us to address is where our hearts are at. And I want to use the parable of the rich fool from Luke chapter 12, verses 13 through 21 to kind of illustrate what it is, to give us an idea of what it is that Jesus wants us to do with our spending. Then someone called from the crowd, "Jesus, please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." Jesus replied, "Friend, who made me a judge over you to decide such things as that?" Then he said, "Beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured of how much you own." Okay, so Jesus says a lot in just that one. He didn't tell people what to do with their money. He basically was like, "Why are you involving me in this? This is up to you." Excuse me. But then he also provides the caution: beware of, you know, what's in your heart, what's behind your desire for you to receive half, or you know, your half of your father's estate. What's behind that request? God wants us to look at our hearts in terms of our spending and how we use money. But the first thing is, Jesus didn't tell them what to do with the money, but he did tell them to think through how they spend their money. Okay, now I'm going to continue on with the parable, and then we'll look at the second thing that Jesus is teaching us about our money. Then he told them a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have room for all my crops." Then he said, "I know. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, 'My friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Come now, take it easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything that you worked for?' Yes, a person is a fool who stores up earthly wealth but does not have a rich relationship with God." So number two, when he says, "My friend, you have," when the person in the parable says to himself, "Self, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Take it easy. Eat, drink, and be merry." Jesus isn't telling us not to enjoy our wealth, but if the purpose of wealth is strictly our own selfish desires and pleasures, God says that's foolish. God says that's foolish. It's a foolish way to approach life. So we want to think through, as we think through, how are we using our money? Are we using it simply to please ourselves? And is it all about ourselves? John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, in his 1789 sermon on the use of money, said that money is a gift from God, and that money in the hands of God's children is food for the hungry, it's drink for the thirsty, it's clothing for the naked. That money isn't just about ourselves. Money is about helping others. And I think when we look at the life of Jesus, we can see that. Jesus used his life, not only his resources. And in the Gospel of John, it says that Judas kept the money bag, and that money that he was given, that people provided to Jesus for his ministry, he used it to provide for the poor when people had needs, that Judas would dole out the money from the money bag. So Jesus did take in money for his ministry, and you know, Jesus had to provide for his own needs. We, you know, when Jesus was hungry, it says, and Jesus is resting in Samaria by the well where he meets the Samaritan woman, it's that they specifically went into town to buy food. So they had money to go and buy food, and they needed food. You know, Jesus had money to provide for his and the disciples' needs, but he also gave freely to others who had need. And so I think what the point here of this parable and what Jesus is telling us about our hearts and how we spend is that it's not just about us and our needs, but it's also about making sure that the needs of others are provided for. And then the third thing I think that from this particular parable and what Jesus is telling us about spending is that we want to be generous, that God is generous. A person who stores up earthly wealth but is not rich toward God, that in being generous to others, we enhance our relationship not only with other people but with God. There is a relationship between God, our relationship with God, and money. And that comes back to what Jesus said in Matthew 6:24, where he says that you cannot serve both God and money. That there is this competing interest in human beings between God and money. That for some reason, and I want to say that it's sort of fear-based, that ultimately we're saying, God, I trust you. But in the back of our minds, we have a plan B. Well, if I have enough money to meet my needs here on earth. So we're saying, yes, God, I trust you. But then we sort of have this idea, well, but just in case, I'm going to have lots of money in the bank. I'm going to have this money backed up. Ultimately, what Jesus was trying to tell us is that God is generous and God loves us. And because God is generous and loves us, God will provide for us. Now, it doesn't mean that we may all be, have our own private jets and so on, but that God will provide for what we need. We just have to trust God. And then there's enough for everybody if we can do that. What happens is that people tend to, who have money, they tend to hoard it for themselves. When we look at the economy, since the 1970s, the average worker, those who like ran companies at the top of the spectrum and those who were like the average worker, they were much closer in what they made. But as companies made more money, instead of that wealth being evenly distributed between those at the top and those who were the average employees, those at the top, their income went up. And in some companies, in some instances, 500 times more than what the average person made. So over since 1970, the average worker's income has sort of gone like this, sort of at a slow pace, but those at the top, their income has gone like this. So what that says is that those at the top who make the most money, they've enriched themselves instead of making sure that all people benefited from the company and the wealth of that, whatever that company is that it made. And I think that's the bigger barns situation that Jesus is talking about. If more money is made, then it needs to benefit more people instead of just a few. And that when we look at wealth as what can I get for myself, then our relationship with God suffers. That we become poor in our relationship with God instead of rich in our relationship with God. So there is a direct relationship about how we spend and then our relationship with God and our relationship with other people. And it's something that Jesus is saying we really, 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 really need to pay attention to. Just as an example, You know, tithing, if you've grown up in a church or been a part of a church, you've probably heard about tithing. Typically, it's been seen as 10% of your gross income, not your net, but your gross. And what I think when we actually tithe off the top of our gross, what we're saying is that God, before I pay my bills and do anything, when I get paid, I take 10% and give that to you and set that aside for you and donate that to church or some nonprofit organization that benefits other people. It's saying, I trust you to provide my needs. That may not make sense to us here, but it's a reflection of what's in our hearts. It's saying, I trust you, God. And God can do great things with our trust. The reality is that for churches to exist, and she makes the point in the book too. She says there are churches who, you know, are palatial. You know, there are these amazing structures that have, you know, coffee shops and things in them. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but is it excess? Because you also have churches that have fallen into great disrepair and are deteriorating because people have not given to maintain those churches. And so there is a balance, right? We don't want to have like opulent churches that ignore the needs of those who have less. But at the same time, we also, when we say, hey, this is an important place for me to come and worship and to experience God and be in the presence of God and God's people, that we also need to make a financial commitment to that. And, you know, it takes money to make Lift go. When we come to gather together and worship on a Sunday at Lift, that doesn't happen with $0. It takes dollars to make that happen. And so we have to make a commitment to our church. And I think when we do, we're saying, God, I trust you to meet my needs, but I also trust that church is a place where you want me to come, to become and be fed spiritually and nurtured by you and your spirit. Yes, that can happen outside the church walls, but there's something special about coming together as God's people. And that takes finances. And we're saying, God, I believe in this and the importance of this, and I'm gonna commit to giving toward it. That is a reality in terms of how we think about our spending. We want to think about how we give to God's work and God's church specifically. So that's all I have for us today. I hope that this was helpful to you in terms of spending. There's a lot of information in spending, but the main thing is there's a relationship between how we spend and how we trust God. And that's about, and that's comes from in our hearts. When we look inside our hearts, Jesus wants us to think through how we spend. And the place we want to start is look inside our hearts and think through how we use our money. All right. I hope this was helpful and this was good. We'll continue on Sunday about spending. And then next week, we'll talk about stress. And next Sunday, talk about stress on Palm Sunday as we go into Easter. All right, I hope this was good. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your gifts of provision to us. And we pray to think through how we use those gifts of provision that you provide to us. We want to use them wisely and well to see your will done on earth as it is in heaven, because we know that your will is good and it does take money to make things happen. And so we ask for wisdom in how to use our money, that your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. And we ask for your spirit to help us and guide us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you for joining, and we'll see you next week.